This work is about a mapping that we did from the properties of natural scenes to cone activation space. And I'm also trying to promote this new image data set that we have in Barcelona and try to convince you to use it. First, Carl Gegenfunder has already talked a lot about this, so he saved me the effort to having to explain the properties of the color coding in the brain. So I'm just gonna say that the main motivation for this work is to try to help people who try to understand how the brain processes color. We all know that everything starts in the retina with a set of photoreceptors, and then they collect color information, they transform it into spikes, and they are transmitted through the optic nerve in the form of opening color channels, red, green, and blue, yellow. And this is okay, except that in general everything starts from a camera, which is basically based on three planes RGB, which are not the same as the LMS cones that are in the retina. So to show you what happens if you just use the RGB planes of a camera and you combine them to form, for example, blue versus yellow or red versus green, you get this sort of images. But if you use proper LMS and you combine them to do the same or approximately the same, you get a very different set of spatial chromatic distributions. So it's important, the message is important to, if you are trying to study what happens in the cortex or in beyond the retina to use LMS. Yeah. Now, I'm trying to outline the problems that we had with representing everything in LMS. You can start with a camera, which of course it's in a represents pictures in a device-dependent color space, which are basically arbitrary photoreceptors, and then you have to do some color space transformation to transform these arbitrary photoreceptors into some device independent color space, like in general is a CIE XYZ color space, and then another to transform it into human cone sensitivities. For example, camera sensors, you want to transform it into CIE 1931 primaries, which are based on the guild, right and guild color matching functions. And the common photoreceptor used in the literature, you know, people used to combine them to make color opponent channels are the Smith and Pokorny, which are related to the Jude-Boss color matching functions. And these two are actually, there isn't an exact transformation between these two. You can transform individual wavelengths, but you cannot transform the whole thing. So what we did in the end was to, instead of having all this transformation which introduced error, to calibrate our camera directly into LMS. So basically to take the sensor responses and map them into LMS cone activation space. And we use Smith and Pokorny, but we could use another one if needed. And there are several ways of measuring the LMS sensor responses. Of course, you can start with a spatial chromatic device and then do the transformation I said before. Of course, they measure the radiometric spectral radiometric properties of a point, are not very useful for whole images. Then there are hyperspectral cameras, which they do exactly what we need. They give you the whole spectral radiometric information for every pixel, but they are a bit cumbersome and slow-ish. I mean, Sergio knows that you need static images basically to be able to use them. They are improving, but still not as good as you need. And of course, this is the option we are trying to do now, which is to calibrate a trichromatic camera, which is cheap, practical. But of course, you don't get the full radiance spectrum for every pixel. If you consider this, hyperspectral cameras are the best, but sometimes you need to explore regularities and how the regularities in the environment shape our sensory systems. And the more complex these regularities, the more scenes you need to gather. Of course, if the regularities are not related to color, you can use uncalibrated imagery. But in general, if you want to work in the chromatic domain, you need to work in a cone activation space, and then you need something that is calibrated. So you need lots of pictures and calibrated ones. So based on that, we decided that having a cheap and practical solution will be best, have lots and lots of images, and to put them online so people can download them. How did we characterize the camera? This is a long story. I'm going to be very, very brief, but basically you need to characterize it in terms of intensity, in terms of wavelength, then do a color mapping, and of course do some tests to show that your characterization is good. The characterization in terms of intensity can be done just measuring with a spectral radiometer device the patches of a Macbeth chart and taking pictures, comparing with the camera, and then finding some relationship. And then you can do the same, but you can characterize the camera in terms of wavelength using this sort of setting when you have a black box, and you shine light through one of the holes in the box through a filter, an infrared blocking filter in this case, to try to eliminate infrared components in the light. Then you bounce the light from a target, and you measure that light through an interference filter, a narrowband interference filter, and you can do the same by replacing the spectral radiometer by a camera. So you take, of course, lots of pictures through, in our case, there were 31 interference filters, and then you get pictures like this, and combined with the information I showed before, you get the response with intensity of the three channels, and you get the response to wavelength of each of the three channels. This is the camera we have now, which is a Foveon SD10. And these are the shape of the sensor sensitivities. Yeah, we checked that because lately I found a little paper in the internet where the camera manufacturers produce these the same functions, but for a sensor that was measured in isolation, so you don't have the lens on top. So this measurement produces the same kind of thing, but with the lens on top, and you get these little waves here, this little waving of the function here, because of the infrared lens that the camera has, which is a bit wavy. So I trust these measurements are quite good. Now the color mapping. Of course, color mapping from one set of spectral sensitivity to another is not exact, except in a very few cases. In general, you need to make some concessions because it's an ill-posed problem. And what we did for the mapping is basically to customize it. I mean, we started with an illuminant, yeah, D65. Then we multiplied by a set of spectral reflectances of Mansell chips, for example. Then you sample it with the camera sensors. You sample it with the human cone sensitivities, and you get set two sets of triplets, RGB and LMS. And then we map the RGB to the LMS set using a polynomial. I mean, there are lots of ways of mapping them, from just a 3x3 matrix to, you know, several combinations of polynomials. We tried a few, and this is quite a good one. It's quite common, I think, in the scanner and printing literature to use this sort of polynomial. In the end, you basically minimize this function and get some polynomial to map one to the other. And to perform the test, we basically took the eight of the scenes that Nascimento and Foster posted in their website, which are hyperspectral scenes. You get the whole spectrum for each pixel. And we did this. We illuminated them. Then we sampled them using the camera sensor, the LMS human responses. And you get from the human responses, you get a picture. And from the sensors, we applied our polynomial transformation, but just using several different training sets, one based on Macbeth card reflectances, another based on Munsell chips, as I showed before, and other reflectances that I'm going to explain later. And our results are basically these. First, the training set one, which were 1,269 Munsell chip reflectances. Training set two, which was based on just 24 reflectances of the Macbeth card. Training set three was based on a set of 219 Northern European reflectances, which were measured by Parkinen in 88, and they're probably reflectancy from objects around here. Then we sample one of the scenes of the Nascimento Foster dataset, the scene number two, which contains mostly chlorophyll plants, and we obtained 341,000 samples. Then we did the same with scene six and seven, which contain urban objects, houses, pavement, all these things. And these were the training sets. And then we basically compared the image that our polynomial produced with the images produced straight from the Nascimento data set. And these are histograms of the errors. Yeah. So you can see all the details of these tables in the CD with the paper. But in general, considering here the table shows the maximum relative errors, which is. Relative error is just a, you know, pixel from one picture, pixel from the ground truth, subtracted and then divided by the maximum, yeah, of the two. Then you get that, you know, the errors are about 5%, 6% in the case of a Munsell. And if you consider that, this is the maximum error, if you consider that also the shape of the histogram and how spread it is. Okay, that's the last one. How it spread. So in the end, the chlorophyll in our case was the best, of course, the best method because the pictures contain a lot of chlorophyll. But also the Munsell was surprisingly very good, and surprising because it's a generalistic method. It's just, you know, we don't make any assumptions about the pictures. And then, of course, the Macbeth was very bad. And the Northern European wasn't as good as we expected, probably because there's a bias towards flowers and colorful objects. So basically, my conclusions are that customized characterization of the camera is feasible. You can do this. So you need a training set which is flexible. You need an expectation of what you want to record, and it's very robust. The Munsell-based polynomial is quite robust. It's quite good. And this is the default one that we have in our data set in Barcelona. And this is the website, and well, this is explained in the web. So that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alex. Questions? A short one.
No.
Sergio.
Do you?
It's okay.
Is this on? Okay. Do you have an idea of how the arrows are distributed in the color space, where the arrows are larger?
Yeah. I took that slide off. Yeah, and this is for the different type of learning sets. We have to amplify. I mean, the scale is logarithmic in the gray levels, and the white is where the largest errors are concentrated. Yeah, for the different training sets.
Can you just remind me how many images
in Barcelona?
Yes.
I don't know. It's growing. Every time we send somebody out, it takes 40 or 70, I think. So if anybody needs a data set, they can send us an email, or maybe we can customize it and just, you know, get the pictures that if you need, I don't know, urban or chlorophyll or something.
Okay, well, thanks very much indeed, Alex.